told his own son, but gave him up for all of us. Will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died. Yes, who was raised? Who is at the right hand of God? Who indeed intercedes for us? Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake, we are all being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Blessed when you're at the end of your rope. With less of you, there is more of God and his rule. You're blessed when you feel you've lost what is most dear to you. Only then can you be embraced by the one most dear to you. You're blessed when you're content with just who you are, no more, no less. That's the moment you find yourselves proud owners of everything that can't be bought. You're blessed when you've worked up a good appetite for God. He's food and drink in the best meal that you'll ever eat. You're blessed when you care. At the moment of being cared for, you find yourselves cared for. You're blessed when you get your inside world, your mind and heart put right. Then you can see God in the outside world. You're blessed when you can show people how to cooperate instead of compete or fight. That's when you discover who you really are and your place in God's family. You're blessed when your commitment to God provokes persecution. The persecution drives you even deeper into God's kingdom. So we've already looked at the Ten Commandments, which were part of the covenant agreement with the people of Israel. And to maintain their relationship with God, they needed to behave as though they were actually God's people. And the struggle of how to do that was shown through the 613 laws found in the Torah, the first five books of the Jewish scriptures. And today we look at the Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes and the teachings contained in that. By Jesus' time, the Pharisees had made big lists, very detailed lists, of what they categorised of sinful behaviour, and they kind of ranked them, and they'd done that in order to try and prevent them from getting anywhere close to breaking the big commands. So kind of like, keep all these minute over the top little laws, and then you're not going to go doing the big stuff like coveting and stealing and killing and things like that. And I guess they kind of thought that those extra laws were there to help people to keep them walking closer to God. But as Jesus pointed out, actually they become empty legalism for some people, and actually for a lot of people, a huge intolerable burden. So many think that Jesus' teachings on the Sermon on the Mount get rid of some of these legalistic rules, but actually intensify the demands of the original laws that were given by God. Because Jesus said, it isn't just about not breaking the law, that isn't enough. It's actually your attitude goes with it. So yeah, murder's wrong. We all know we shouldn't go around murdering people, and I would confidently state that everybody in here hasn't committed a murder and can hold their hands up and say that's one commandment that they haven't broken. But actually, Jesus says the attitude that goes with it. Being angry with somebody, particularly harbouring that resentment for years, is like murdering them in your heart or in your mind. And it's all very well being pious and saying, I'm not a murderer, if inside us we're harbouring that resentment. And that's a challenge. That challenges those who believe that they can keep the laws perfectly, but they don't have the attitude of love that God has for his people. And that's quite freeing for those who are oppressed and those who are downtrodden and for those sinners in society, but it's a challenge and one we still feel today. One of the children I used to teach at school became a pilot. A bit worrying, I think I'd freak out if I got on a plane and was flying, because in my head he's still 12.
Okay.
But pilots describe attitude, use that term attitude, to describe a horizontal relationship with the runway when they come into land. And if their attitude isn't aligned properly, then they've got a problem because they're going to crash. They're at the wrong angle. And in essence, our attitude can be used in the same way. It's our inward disposition towards people and circumstances. And that's in with the plane. Our attitude is applied whenever we deal attitudes, and our attitudes should become like that of Jesus. Today, many people in our nation mourn the death of Prince Philip, and our hearts go out especially to the Queen in her loss. But we know that in her strong faith, may she remember the words of the Beatitudes, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." I'm sure her grief is intense. They've been married for such a long time, and he's been her close companion and confidant. But she's not blind to the reality of God's saving grace and his plan for all believers. Her comfort today will rest in the thought that Prince Philip is now with God. Now, Prince Philip was well known for being outspoken in many ways, quite a controversial figure, and I love that about him. But he used to offer the Dean of Windsor constructive criticism after each of his sermons. So I'm a little bit worried about saying anything about him today, really. He constantly had the attitude of putting the interests of others ahead of his own. And in doing so, he provided an outstanding example of Christian service. He was the Queen's Rock, who contributed massively to the success of her reign. The legacy he leaves is enormous. At school, I attempted to do the Duke of Edinburgh's award. It was founded in 1956 and has inspired generations of young people, hasn't it? I was a failure, I'm afraid. We got lost on a bronze expedition trip. We ended up in a BBC TV van at the top of Winter Hill, waiting till the teacher found us, back before the days of mobile phones, with lots of radio messages going from the TV company to the head offices and the phone and the police and the, they found us in the end, but it put me off. My own two boys, though, were much more successful and both achieved their gold award. They had that vision instilled in them of citizenship and a desire to serve the communities. They followed that beatitude of Prince Philip's instigation of being blessed when you can show people how to cooperate instead of compete or fight. Alistair had the privilege of meeting and talking to Prince Philip at his presentation at St James's Palace. And he was quite controversial, much to his absolute delight. Jonathan got Edward, much to his annoyance. Sure, Edward's lovely, but it wasn't the same as having Prince Philip. Meanwhile, I enjoyed it vicariously through the presentation of Alistair. Prince Philip's work with countless charities and organisations reflected his wide-ranging global interests in so many different topics. Wildlife, sport, engineering, interfaith dialogue, design. His powerful advocacy for conservation was years ahead of his time as he brought people from around the world to a new commitment to action for the future of our planet. He embodied those attitudes that we have talked about. And I wonder what our attitudes are like and how we can compare them to Prince Philip and indeed our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, I want to sum that up in a little story. There was a man who went to a service at his church one Sunday. This was obviously pre-COVID times, so you'll understand as I go on. Pulled a bass when Adele got a wrong note. Did well to catch that, because Adele never plays wrong notes, very rare. He glared menacingly at the giggling children. He looked repeatedly at his watch. When the offertory plate was passed around, he felt that people were staring at him to see how much money he gave. He sat tight-lipped during the hymn singing. In the sermon, he felt pleased when he caught the preacher making a slip of the tongue. And he sneaked out early during communion, muttering, "That's a terrible service, I don't know why I bother." Another man went to a worship service on the same Sunday. He chuckled at the sight of a father exchanging hugs with happy toddlers. During the offertory, he wondered, God has given me so many good things in my life. Am I giving enough back in gratitude to God? He struggled honestly with the content of the Bible readings. Part of the sermon helped him with a question that he'd often thought about. He joined in enthusiastically with the singing of the hymns. And as he left church, he thought to himself, how good it is to be here together with my friends in God's presence as part of God's family. Both men had gone to the same church on the same Sunday to the same service, and each had found the exact experience of what they were looking for. Attitude made all the difference. Jesus encouraged people to build up rather than tear down. I've been talking this week to Carol and to Joanne. We pray particularly for Alison today as she undergoes an operation to help with her recovery. But they've spoken to a doctor this week whose attitude made a difficult time for them even harder. And then another doctor who actually built up and didn't tear down and comforted them at a time when they needed that love and compassion. Our attitude has incredible power in how it affects others. And we all need to use that power in a light that benefits one another and makes Christ present in everything that we do. Archbishop Justin spoke this week of Philip's death, and he reminded us that as we recover and we rebuild after the terrible trial that we've gone through during this coronavirus pandemic, we will all need that strength and fortitude and a deep sense of commitment and serving others. Throughout his life, Prince Philip displayed those qualities in abundance. And I pray today that we can take inspiration from his example and to be as Christ-like as we can with the attitude that shows the right side of God's love to everybody. Amen.
Follow Jesus!
He made to our national life and the
the encouragement he gave to so many, especially to the young.
Lord Jesus.
Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray for all who witness to your resurrection, for those who speak of your presence, for preachers of the word and ministers of the sacraments, especially for Reverend Tracy. We pray for those who reveal your presence by the way they live, for all who live simply, that others may simply live. We pray for all who are in doubt, and for all who are seeking you. We pray for the unity of the church in the world. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for our bishops, Julian, Philip and Jill, for Archdeacons Mark and David and Dean Peter, as they lead the diocese and support the parishes as we come to unlocking and resetting parish ministry. In the diocese, we pray for Accrington St Andrew, St Mary Magdalene, and St Peter and Church Kirk. In our parish, we remember all those to be confirmed next month. For the diocesan vision, we ask that it becomes normal for every parish to be planting congregations and churches. We pray for the parish link between St Mary's Clitheroe and Shandala and Gardessen in Branchmire, for those working and volunteering with the Muslim Maria AIDS Ministry in the Free State, and in the Anglican cycle of prayer, the Church of the Province of the Indian Ocean. Lord, in your mercy. We come today with all of us, with all who have lost their freedom, all who have lost hope. We pray for all who have been taken hostage, all who have been imprisoned with their beliefs, that in the darkness they may find your love. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those in authority, Queen Elizabeth and all the royal family in their time of sorrow and grief, for our government and governments around the world, that they lead in a godly and quiet manner for the good of all. We pray for the situation in Northern Ireland and all areas around the world where there is conflict and unrest. We pray for a fair distribution of the coronavirus vaccine, irrespective of wealth or power. And we remember those affected by the volcano in the Caribbean and those facing famine in North Korea. Lord, in your mercy.
You do.
We pray for any community to which we belong, for clubs, welfare organisations, for social groups, and for those with whom we share our worship. We give thanks for your appearing in the approval and pray for our homes and families. We remember those living in Portland Road and Primrose Terrace. We give thanks for our school community, praying that all staff and pupils have had a good restful break and are ready to return to learning tomorrow. Lord, in your mercy. We remember all who are despairing, those who doubt their abilities. We pray for all who lack confidence, those afraid to trust themselves or others. We remember all who are lonely and all who are fearful. We pray for those who are ill in many different ways, looking to you for hope. We remember those who are in nursing homes, Lucy Walters, Dean Douglas, and Marjorie Talbert. And we pray for those we know who are ill in the mind or spirit, Joan Bentham, Margaret Blair, Isabel Brown, Mirko Kastik, Neve Evans, Lauren Hall, Jodie Hilton, Alison Holden, Elsie Holt, Lisa Johnson, Kerry Lowe, Spencer Pierce, and Jack Turner. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Risen Lord, in you is our hope, in life, in death, and to eternity our hope is in you. We rejoice with all who have entered into the fullness of life eternal. We pray especially for loved ones who have recently died, for Colin Bradford and for Prince Philip. And we pray for Natalie Meister, Catherine,
Jesus says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. The peace of the risen Lord be always with you."
And also with you.
Jesus, come before.
Jesus Christ. We offer you through him this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, granted by his merits and death, and through faith in his blood, we and all your church may receive forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. Although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer you any sacrifice, yet we pray that you will accept this, the duty and service that we owe. Do not weigh our merits, but pardon our offences, and fill us all who share in this holy communion with your grace and heavenly blessing. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Rejoicing in God's new creation, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. image on earth is a sign of your heavenly peace, an image of the new and eternal Jerusalem. Grant to us in the days of our pilgrimage that fed with the living bread of heaven and united in the body of your Son, we may be the temple of your presence, the place of your glory on earth, and a sign of your peace in the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. God grant to the living grace, to the departed rest, to the Church, the Queen, the Commonwealth, and all humankind peace and concord, and to us and all his servants life everlasting. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you.